Hello there, I'm Thundaga, and welcome to my How to Make a Pokemon Game tutorial series. This series will cover all of the essential info you need to make a Pokemon game in RPG Maker and Pokemon Essentials. In this episode, we'll discuss the basics for getting started. First, we'll look at RPG Maker and the version that you need to make fan games. Second, we'll download Pokemon Essentials and install the Hotfixes plugin. And finally, we'll open up the Pokemon Essentials project in RPG Maker and make our very first map, and then walk around in it. With all that said, let's get into it. So the first thing you'll need to get started is RPG Maker, specifically RPG Maker XP. There are plenty of other versions of RPG Maker, such as VX or MZ, but those are not compatible with Pokemon Essentials. The reason for this is that Pokemon Essentials is an RPG Maker XP project that can only be opened with RPG Maker XP. XP can be bought from the official RPG Maker website or from Steam. I have the Steam version, and as you can see, I've used it for a couple of hours. During Steam sales, the price of XP can drop to as low as $2.50. I've done a couple XP giveaways in the past as well, and I'll probably do another in the future. Now let's look into downloading Pokemon Essentials. Currently, the latest version of Pokemon Essentials is version 20.1. You can download it from Relic Castle, as well as a few other places, but for now, I would recommend going to reliccastle.com/essentials. The link to this will be in the video description as well. Relic Castle is an awesome website for all your Pokemon fangame needs, and it hosts tons of useful resources, as well as fangame downloads and even game jams. In this tutorial series, we will be going to Relic Castle a lot. To begin downloading Pokemon Essentials, just click on the Download V20.1 right here, and then your download will begin automatically once you get to the Mediafire site. Next, we want to download the V20.1 hotfixes as well, so be sure to click on V20.1 hotfixes, and then click on the Go to Download button here in the top right. This will also take you to a Mediafire site, and then you can click on the Download button to download the hotfixes. Alright, now that I've got the Pokemon Essentials project and the hotfixes downloaded, it's time to unzip them. The downloads come as zip files, so we need to unzip them before we can use them. Thankfully, it's super easy to unzip files. What I like to do is just go and right-click on them and hit Extract. From here, you can choose where to extract your files to. Looking at the directory here, it looks like it's going to my Pokemon Stuff folder and then V20 Tutorials, and then making a new folder called Pokemon Essentials. I would rather just put everything into the V20 Tutorials folder, so I'm just gonna go extract to here, and then hit extract. This can take a little bit, so I'll cut in when that's done extracting. Alright, it looks like our Pokemon Essentials folder's finished extracting. We can double-click it to open it and look inside and see all the cool stuff here, but we also still need to do the same for our hotfixes. Thankfully, this is going to be extremely fast because the hotfixes are only a couple files. So let's extract that real quick. Bada boom, look, it's already done. Cool. So, before we get started, we also need to install these hotfixes, and you'll be pleased to know that this is an extremely easy process. Looking inside, let's make sure we have all the files that they want. Cool. All you need to do is grab the hotfixes folder and put it into our Pokemon Essentials plugins folder. So, let's just grab it. I'm just going to copy it, go into plugins, and paste. Ta-da! And there we go. The hotfixes have been installed. Just making sure, look at that. If you want to, you can open meta.txt and you can look and see some of the changes that have been made in previous hotfix versions. And to clarify, these V20.1 hotfixes are only compatible with Pokemon Essentials version 20.1. If a new version comes out, for example, version 21.0, you should not install the V20.1 hotfixes. Only install the hotfixes for your version if a corresponding hotfix exists. Now that we have our hotfixes installed, let's actually open our Pokemon Essentials project. First, let's open the folder and take a look at what we've got inside. Inside our project's root folder are some more folders that we'll cover in more detail in the future, but as a basic summary, we have audio for music and sound effects, we have data for map files and scripts, we have fonts for fonts, we have graphics for sprites and tile sets and so much more, we have PBS for a lot of different tweakable text values, and then, as you know, plugins. To actually open the project though, you'll want to scroll on down to game.rxproj. Double-click the game.rxproj to open Pokemon Essentials in RPG Maker XP. And here we go! Here, this is Lappet Town. This is the first town in our Pokemon Essentials project. Pokemon Essentials comes with a lot of different maps that you can browse here in the bottom left. This is the map list. You can right-click any maps to edit their map properties, or at any time you can make a new map. In the top left here is the tile set browser, which consists of all the tiles that are used in this tile set and that can be drawn in this map. There are plenty of other options we can go through here as well, but since this is the first episode and we're just covering the basics, let's just focus on making a new map and then playtesting it real quick and then call it a day. To make a new map, just right-click anywhere in the map list and then select New Map. From here, you'll see a window for your map's properties. First is the map's name. Let's just call our map something basic like Test Town for now. Next is the tile set. You can select from a bunch of different tile sets here. For example, if you wanted to make a gym or a cave or just an interior map, but for our test town, let's choose outside. Next is the width and height. I like to make my maps kind of big and then whittle them down over time and refine them. So let's start with something like 40 by 30. These values can always be changed later too, so don't stress out too much about setting the perfect width and height here, but also make sure not to set them too high. If you go with something massive like 100 by 100, there's a good chance your game will lag and run poorly. While we're on the subject of do's and don'ts, don't worry about the encounters or steps average fields on the right here. These values are not used by Pokémon Essentials and you don't have to worry about them. Next is Auto Change BGM and Auto Change BGS. I basically always use Auto Change BGM and I hardly ever use Auto Change BGS. BGM is background music for your map, and setting it here will make it so that way when you first enter the map, it will automatically change to start playing the background music. BGS is background sound. So for example, if you wanted to have a map with like rain and raining effects, but also having music, you could have background sound for rain and raindrops, and then background music for your map. But I'm just gonna go with some background music. How about Sidolin City? Let's listen to that. Oh yeah. That's some good music. That's certainly cooler than Celadon City. All right, let's accept that and use that for our map. And here we go. We have ourselves a lovely empty map. Now that our empty map is created, let's start filling it out by adding tiles from the tile set. To do this, you want to select the Layer 1, Layer 2, or Layer 3 buttons up here in the top bar. Layer 1 is the lowest layer and is typically used for stuff like ground or grass. Layer 2 is then the next highest layer, and Layer 3 is the top layer. Layer 2 and 3 are typically used for everything above the ground, like trees or houses. Let's start now by adding some cool grass to our map. What I'd recommend is just clicking on the grass in the tile set, making sure we're on layer 1, and then left-clicking in our map to start drawing some grass. But this is pretty slow. To speed up this process, we can click on the Paint Bucket tool here, and then just left-click and it'll fill in all the empty spaces with grass. Now look at that, that's a pretty nice start to our map. There are also rectangle draw tools and ellipse draw tools for if you want to draw a circle or something, but I don't use these too often, but it's nice to know that they're there. Alright, now that we've added some tiles to the ground layer, let's start adding some trees to the second layer. To do this, let's first go back to our pencil draw and select the second layer. Now, let's scroll down through our tile set until we find a nice tree. Here we go, that's a nice looking tree. So what we could do is we could click on an individual tile and then click on another individual tile, but this is kind of slow. There is a faster way to draw trees. You can right click and drag to select multiple tiles at the same time from the tileset browser, and then you can left click anywhere to draw that selection. And look at that. Now we can left click in multiple places and draw multiple trees. Now that's pretty convenient. If we want, we could even use this process to draw an entire house at the same time. If we keep on scrolling down through the tile set, here we go, that's a nice looking house. I like this one here with the blue roof. You can right click and drag and select the whole dang thing, and then left click and then bada boom. We can start drawing houses everywhere. Now that's a pretty nice looking town, wouldn't you say? As a pro tip, you can also use this right click and drag tool to select empty space and then use it as a form of erasing things. I use this all the time. Right clicking and dragging has to be my most commonly used shortcut when it comes to making maps here in Pokémon Essentials. Like let's say we want to delete some of those trees or some houses. I can just right click and drag this empty space and then left click and bada boom. Look at that. I'm essentially painting over them with emptiness. And this is extremely convenient. I highly recommend getting used to right-clicking and dragging as a form of moving things or deleting things when it comes to making maps in Pokémon Essentials. It'll save you so much time, and yeah, this has to be one of the most used things. And it's so simple, right-click and drag. Another pro tip, if you want to isolate a layer when making maps, you can press the F4 key on your keyboard. I use this a lot as well. This makes it easier to tell which layer you're currently looking at when editing a map. Here we can see that layer 2 has been highlighted and layer 1 has been dimmed. If we go to view layer 1, look at that, the layers above it are no longer visible. And we want to make them visible, we can hit F3. And look at that, now we have kind of like a shadow overlay. So F3 and F4 are very useful. And last but not least, another extremely useful shortcut that I like to use is Control-Z to undo. At any time, let's say you're clicking and dragging, and then you think to yourself, oh, I made a mistake, I'd love to undo that. You can hit Control-Z and undo any action. And this also works for multiple actions in a row. So you could draw this and draw that, and you'd be like, you know what, I dislike both of those lines. Control-Z, Control-Z. Bada boom. That's another extremely useful shortcut. So between right-clicking and then F4 and Control-Z, those are all things that I use all the time when making maps. Now, I know this map is a little bit ugly, but let's start getting in and playtesting this map as one final thing before we end this tutorial. This next part of the video will probably be the most complicated part of the video because it briefly touches on events, but don't worry, we'll go through it pretty slowly and in a couple minutes time, we'll be playtesting our game. First, select the Events Editor, which is next to Layer 3 here in the top bar. Events are what will end up powering a lot of your game, and we'll cover them in a lot more detail in the future, but for now, let's just go to the Intro Map. This is a pretty empty looking map, but in the top left and bottom left are two events. In the top left is the Full Intro, which typically plays when you start the game and Professor Oak talks to you. At any time, you can right-click and select Edit Event, to view some of this, but don't worry, this is kind of complicated stuff, and we will cover all of this in the future. So you don't have to worry too much about the event commands here. For now, what we want to do is we want to disable the full intro though. So in order to do this, in the bottom section here, where it says auto run, instead, let's just change this to action button for now, and then hit apply, so it doesn't run anymore. And then we can hit okay to close this out. What we want to do is instead go to the bottom left here, because this is the quick start intro. What this does is it skips that whole spiel where Professor Oak talks to you and just teleports you to a map and changes your name and sets a couple other variables. Since we want to make it so that way the quick start intro automatically plays, let's go down into the trigger and change that one to auto run. Now, whenever we enter this map, the quick start intro will automatically play. And just like that, we're already almost done. There's only one more thing that we need to do. In the middle of the event commands here for the quick start intro is a transfer player command. What this does is teleports the player to a map. And as we can see right here, it's transferring us to map 3, which is the player's house. But we want to edit it so it transfers us to our cool new map that we made. So instead, let's just do right click, edit, and then in the direct appointment field here, we can just double click this and start browsing through the map list. We made a cool new map called Test Town. And what we can do is we can also scroll through the map here and then left click on a point and that will be where we are teleported to. So let's just teleport in front of this house for now. This is a pretty cool looking house and we'll probably make this our house. And then just hit okay. Then after that, we can also select the direction here. Let's make it so our player is facing down. We don't have to worry too much about a fade. And for a point with variables, I'd say don't worry about this. Don't bother with this. And then just hit okay. There we go. Now as we can see, we are now warping to map 22, which is called Test Town. And then next to that is the coordinates, which is 12, 8. We'll be facing down and there's no fade. 12 is the X, 8 is the Y. And then now we can hit apply. And just like that, when we start our game, we will be warped to our cool new map. There are two quick things though that I want to cover really quick though before we start playtesting the game. First is changing the game's name. In order to do this, you should go to the top bar here and select Game, then go down and select Change Title. This will give you the prompt to change your game's name, and by default, it's Pokémon Essentials V20.1. Let's just call our game Thundaga Tutorials V20 for now. The reason that we want to have a unique game name is because save data is created and loaded based on the game name you've selected. And it's probably not a good idea to have your game name be Pokémon Essentials V20.1. If somebody else has the exact same game name, Pokémon Essentials V20.1, weird stuff can happen where two games are using the same save data, and we probably don't want that. Secondly, I'd like to briefly discuss the difference between debug mode and non-debug mode. If you hit the green arrow here in RPG Maker, you'll begin playtesting the game in debug mode, which gives you access to some very useful debugs for testing. These debugs can be accessed from the pause menu or by pressing the F9 key on your keyboard. To playtest the game without debug mode, you need to go into the games folder and then run game.exe. This will disable access to debug and more properly emulate the experience that players who playtest your game will have. I highly recommend testing your game both in debug mode and in non-debug mode, because sometimes that can be critical for catching bugs that you may have missed if you're only playing in debug mode. Alright, with all that said, let's start playtesting our game. To do that, we can, as we mentioned earlier, click on the green arrow here to playtest, and as you'll see, it'll open a command prompt window and our game. This will show you compiler progress as well as loaded plugins. As we can see, the V20.1 Hotfixes plugin has been loaded, and there were no compiler issues. Sometimes this can take a little bit when it's compiling all the changes, but we didn't really have any changes, so it was very fast for us. Now, let's hit new game and start testing out our cool map. Hey, there we are, we're in Test Town! Look at this lovely map. This map is certainly great and not hastily thrown together in the slightest. Plus, that music is kinda slapping. And yeah, that's about it. I think that's gonna do it for episode 1. Thank you so much for watching. To access all the links and everything that I mentioned in the video, be sure to check the description. I'm creating a new page on my website for tracking every single tutorial, so there will be a hub for all the info I cover in one spot. I'll try to keep this page updated for every new tutorial video also. Making Pokémon fan games is a lot of fun, and you don't really need to know any programming to get started and make something great. For those who are interested in some more advanced subjects like programming, we'll be certain to cover some of those in the future, but for now, we'll be looking into more beginner subjects, and then covering all the basics of making a Pokémon game. Thank you so much for watching, I hope you learned something, and I hope that you have a good one. Remember to like and subscribe for more tutorials in the future. Bye now! Ooh, Crash Bandicoot.